Welcome, Manika Kaur. Yes, it's me, Pam Sidhu, here at Punjab 2000 with the beautiful Manika Kaur. And you can hear something there in the background. Yes, it's the Vaheguru Simran that she did many years ago. Now, you might not know this, Manika, but I used to listen to this with my husband. What was it? Between, I don't know, more than 10 years ago, maybe 15 years ago. This is before we knew it was you. So welcome.
Thank you.
It's so lovely to finally be able to speak with you and highlight the amazing work that you are doing and that you have been doing. So for those of you who, you know, do not know, Manika Kaur is a leading person in the field of Kirtan, bringing about Kirtan with a difference. You know, I've always related to the Kirtan that you have created. It's a different sound. For those of us that are living outside of India, for people like myself that are born here, for example, in the UK, I've always really resonated with the sound. It's like a new sound that's created. So thank you for all the great work that you have done. And we're going to talk quite a bit about the work that you have done and your up and coming album as well in this interview. But, you know, thank you for taking the time for us today at Punjab 2000 to share with us the amazing work that you have and that you are doing. But let's take it right back. How did you get into singing?
thank you for actually listening, because Kirtan is, it's not a very popular genre. So I once sat with this producer, his name's Robin Miller, and he actually produced Sade, and he's known as the original smooth operator. He asked me, why Kirtan? Because you realize that in the world of music, Kirtan is like a speck, it's just a grain of sand. And so I explained to him that it's because that's what comes from within me, and I'm not trying to be on billboards and, you know, get a career in Hollywood or something like that. I'm just trying to share this sound that I feel inside me. So I actually started singing Kirtan from a very young age. And I really, everything really started with my parents. I would say that Guru Nanak's philosophies really changed my father's course of his life. And when he became spiritual and more religious, we kind of followed. He was our leader in a way. And when we were living in Melbourne, my dad actually bought 20 bajas and tablas and donated them to the Gurdwara there, at which point each of us got a baja and tabla, and that's how his children started singing Kirtan. So just kind of one good act brought Kirtan into his home, which is something he always says. So it started just singing in the Gurdwara in Melbourne. And I think I was very lucky because Melbourne at the time, Australia was just so far from everything else that we could never get Baijis or Kirtan teachers to come to Australia. So in a way, I wish I had training in Kirtan. I wish I had learned rags. I wish I had the opportunity. But what was wonderful about it was we were so encouraged by our community to discover Sikhi as freely as we wanted and to express love for God any way we wanted. And so as children, some people were playing violin, some people were playing keyboards. You had young boys playing tabla and kind of rapping in our Gurdwara. And
like
so I really, it was just brilliant because there were no rules. And with those kids that I grew up with, all of us have managed to hold on to Sikhi. And it was because it bloomed from within us versus having it shoved down our throat in a way or using fear to control us. It was this love that blossomed from within. Yeah. So it really
started to just self-express using these instruments. I mean, I can just imagine, you know, all of a sudden receiving a tabla, a baja, and being allowed to freestyle with it, you know? Yeah. So you were born in Australia, you were born in Melbourne, is that right?
Yes.
So you had that Western influence, and you can hear that really clearly in your music, you know, in the Kirtan. And it's amazing, like, you know, the way you just expressed it then is for you, it was, you know, the community allowed you to just express your love for Vaheguru through the Kirtan in the way that it flowed through you freely. And you can hear that very clearly in your music today, you know, which is why so many of us relate to it. But then things changed, right? Because then you moved from Australia and you moved, was it
Dubai?
Dubai,
right? Yes.
And, you know, if you could just, I know some people may have heard before, but if you could just recap for us the magic that happened then, because there was no, was there no Gurdwara? Is that, yeah. I'll let you tell us exactly how it went down.
You remember it correctly. I had an arranged marriage at 23 and I moved from Melbourne to Dubai. And it was very odd for me because I grew up in a very spiritual home. And so all of a sudden I was in this place where there was no Gurdwara, there was no place for the community to get together and to worship. And just thinking that I'm starting my life here and I'm going to become a mother here. Where will my children find connection or answers, or where can they turn to for guidance? Where can they go to feel connected to other members of their community? And these things kind of weighed in my mind. And my husband's family had been trying to get permission for the Gurdwara for several years. And in 2006, I got married in May. And actually on my birthday, on the 12th of July, the permission came through. And so I had this feeling that God was kind of with me in a way. I mean, you know, we look at things and make them make sense to our life. And kind of being all alone in Dubai at 23 and living with basically strangers, it really meant a lot, really impacted me. And so I started to just do ardas and pray and ask God, let me be a part of this. Let me somehow contribute in whatever small way, but let me be a part of it. And that's when I had this dream. And I saw, I'm holding the CD in my dream, and I see that the CD says it's raising money for building the Guru Nanak Darbar in Dubai. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, okay. And I turn over the CD and I see a picture of myself. And I woke up with the realization like, oh, it was me. I made that CD. And then it was like 4 a.m. when I woke up. So I went back to sleep. And then I told my husband about the dream and he was like, yeah, let's make it happen. I have a very, very wonderful partner in my life. So it started from there. And then a few months later, it was Guru Nanak's Gurpurab. And we had this kirtan at home. And Sukhbir, who is the Prince of Bhangra, came over with his wife. And my husband just spoke to him and said, you know, my wife wants to do this. Can you recommend a producer? And he was just like, I'll do it. And he did the entire album, produced the entire album for free. Wow. The company that printed the booklets that went inside the album, they did it for free. The company that made the actual physical CDs, they did it for free. And I ended up with an album that was free of cost, not that I was expecting it to be, that raised over 1 million dirhams, so over £200,000, all of which was donated towards building the Gurdwara. And honestly, I thought, if I raised £10,000, that would be like my dream, like, wow. And the album, it just went beyond what I could imagine. It had a life of its own. And it was all those people involved and even all the people who helped to sell the album, who I had friends coming over and taking a big box and going and selling it and helping to raise funds. And I remember and cherish all of that and all the people who really supported the album and the cause. So it was after that that I kind of sat there and I thought, well, what next? And so that's how I established my charity, Kirtan for Causes. And since then, I've been releasing albums and 100% of everything goes towards charity. And most of my charity work focuses in Punjab at the moment.
Yes. You've been doing a lot of active work in Punjab for a long time. I know when I met you all those years ago at the Sikh Awards, you were talking very passionately about the work that you were doing then. Some really, you know, thought-provoking, horrifying, really, I would go as far as saying horrifying stories that you had told us that you had even witnessed in Punjab. Obviously now we know that there's the biggest mass protest happening ever in history, highlighting the plight of the farmers, which is amazing that it's, you know, become more and more in public view. But this is something that you have been working on and doing your little bit to help for many years now. So
10 years.
You, how many years?
10 years.
10 years, yeah.
I've been talking about this for 10 years. I've been talking about farmer suicide, the difficulties that farming families face just to feed their children. Forget about even trying to put their children into school. We would go and we would adopt the children from a farming family, and weeks later, their father would commit suicide. And we were thinking, we're making a difference. We've taken on this, kind of taken this off their shoulders. Yeah. They now do not need to worry about educating their children, and the schools that their kids were going to provides uniform, books, and a meal at school. So we thought we were making a difference, and yet it still wasn't enough for these particular families. Yeah. Whereas with other families, it made a massive difference. But with farming families, it was really hard to kind of fully grasp what they were facing and going through. So seeing these protests going on and the amount of support the farming community is getting is so important, and it's about time.
Yes.
And I have been talking about it for 10 years saying,
You have.
People, we need to go. We need to look at what's happening there. They need help. They need support. And when I spoke at the SEEK Awards, when I spoke at Trafalgar Square, when I spoke at Houses of Parliament, I've taken every opportunity to talk about this one thing. So it's just great to see that support is finally there.
Absolutely. And you've been an integral part of highlighting that issue, as you mentioned, for 10 years, and donating all the proceeds all the profits from your albums to that cause as well to help. But how did that happen? Because you weren't born in the Punjab, you were born in Australia. What brought it? Can you remember that defining moment where it actually came into your consciousness of there being a problem here? And connecting the dots of how you yourself can actually help to make that difference. What happened?
So Sikhi really changed my family's life in the most profound way, especially for my parents. A lot of people don't know that my dad, when he got married to my mom, they moved to Adelaide. My dad's first job was cleaning a butcher's shop. And my mom's first job while she was pregnant with my brother was working in a factory. A garment factory. And so my dad wished that his children wouldn't be poor the way he was poor. He lived in a tiny flat with five other family members. And, you know, my brother was born and my mom was immediately pregnant with my second brother. And so he wished for a better life. And when in 1984, when we moved to Bangkok, at the time also when they were in Australia, my parents weren't very religious, but they were very honest people and they would share what they had with others. And I think maybe that pure intention was there. So the universe kept pushing them in the right direction. So when they moved to Bangkok in 1984, my mom was born in Thailand, Punjabi Sikh, but born in Thailand. They met Gyani Arjun Singh and he really sparked this love for Sikhi and encouraged all of us to do Mool Mantar Mala. So when my dad started doing the Mool Mantar Mala, there was a change within him. And he started to hear this calling out from within to make God his partner. And about 5 years later, he opened a bank account, and it's the Dasvant account, or we call it God's money. And he made God a 10% partner in his business. At that time, my parents had started a small garment business where monthly they were selling about 4,000 garments a month. From the day that my dad made God his partner, within a year, they were selling 250,000 pieces.
Amazing.
So his business exponentially grew. And it was that really pulled the family from poverty to privilege. And so my siblings and I grew up with a lot of privilege. Mm. And we started to travel to Amritsar every year. And when my dad started to become aware of the problems there, it deeply affected him because Sikhi gave him so much, yet here in the heart of Sikhi, there is poverty, there is drug abuse, people are in pain, people are lost. And he would describe it as an ocean of despair. And I remember going every year, but it was around the time when I was 16. My dad had started this program of educating children, this initiative, that I was standing next to a girl who was, I think, 15 or 14. and looking at her life compared to my life. Why was I so privileged? Why did I have a bed to sleep on and a bathroom to use and shower in and a home, a roof over my head and an education? These things that just came so easily. And for this girl who could be me, I mean, her entire story was so heartbreaking. Her mother died from cancer. She was split up from her brothers and sisters. She was living with an uncle. She had no future, no hope, especially being female. There was no importance to educate girls. It was like, just put the boys and educate them. And the girls were almost left to rot in a way.
Yeah.
And education, the way that she spoke about being able to go to school, the way that it lit her up. And we take it so for granted. I think, though, after COVID, after a year of lockdown, kids are like, I love school. Send me to school. But yeah, I mean, so it was that moment really when I kind of recognized my privilege.
Yeah.
That I realized that I have this privilege and it's my responsibility to do something with it.
And so, that you definitely have. So all those years later, that experience stayed with you. And I think the way that you've described, you know, the way your dad felt about it in terms of the way he described it as an ocean of despair. I know that a lot of like our parents' generation, because when they left Punjab, say, for example, the people that left in the 60s or the 70s, it wasn't that bad. You know, they left their home, their motherland. And then for us being born abroad, when we've gone back and we've seen it, it's a shock, you know?
Yeah.
I mean, you know, Gurdas Mann, I'm a big fan of his, and his song, Rangla Punjab Mera Kala Ho Gaya, you know? We always think about Rangla Punjab and having this ideology of this being this amazing place. But is it? And you saw the problems, the despair there. So you set up Keep Them for Causes. 10 years, you know, it's been going strong. Educating women, helping with period poverty, helping, you know, in terms of farmer suicides. You've been doing a lot of great work there. So for you personally as well on your journey, it must be a bit of a relief. I don't know, you tell me, is it for you the fact that now this has got global attention, the fact that there is problems there, you know?
We are love. How do we sit quietly while entire countries burn to the ground, bombs blasting children to pieces, while we catch it on our selfies hanging out at hip places? What do these pictures prove? Who are they for? Why are we so afraid to take a stand in controversial issues? Let's rise up and roar. No more bombings, no more wars, no more homeless on the streets. Let's work together. Practice peace. Let's talk about governments that condemn freedom of speech, lock them up like animals for their beliefs. Why are women still not equal? When did feminist become a dirty word? What is wrong with this world? Governments bailing out banks and big corporations while the masses lose their savings. And more despair is created through propaganda, promoting hate, targeting people because of their faith. What is going on? We want peace. No more pieces torn. Let's rise up and roar. We are kindness. We are compassion. We are one. Hear us roar. We are love. We are love. We are love. We are love.
I think that now there's so many people getting involved, which that's really what needs to happen. I think while there is a lot of focus on helping the farmers overturn these three new laws, what I've been saying for the longest time is, if each family can adopt just one child for education, so sponsor just one child and help that child with everything that child may need, whether it's a laptop. Laptops in India are not that expensive. you know, whether they need some counseling or some kind of guidance, do it as if it's your own child. And help that child get to that point where they have a job, where they're earning money, where they're stable, and where they know that somewhere in the world, there's somebody they can count on. Within a generation, we can reverse what's happening in Punjab today. Because to do nothing, right now with the over 50% of the rural male youth are addicted to drugs. Yeah. So if you continue to leave these children to rot, they will turn to drugs. That
leads to many of the problems, you know. So it's a
to think about rehabilitating. Do you know the cost of rehabilitating addicts? It's so high to try to bring in doctors and create rehab facilities. Before we get to that place, which would be almost impossible to reverse from, if we go in and educate the children, we can basically turn their lives around and stop this rapid decline that's happening. You know, we need to realize as a community that 70%, 76% of Sikhs in the world, in the entire world, live in Punjab. So the majority of our brethren live in Punjab. If we can't come together to focus on Punjab together, to educate those children, support their families, support our farmers, and we think it's okay to leave them to fend for themselves, then we are failing our own community, but we're also failing what it means to be Sikh.
Yes, yes. And there's going to be people watching this right now where you're going to be striking a chord in them. You know, maybe people didn't think before, hang on, yeah, I can adopt a child, as in terms of paying for the education.
The dollar a day.
Yeah, right.
It's less than a cup of coffee a day.
So for somebody watching this right now, how do they do that? How do they go about doing that?
So, I mean, there is an online initiative here, which is great, which I actually helped set up at the beginning, which is educatetosave.com, where you can go straight online in the UK. It's a proper registered charity. It will allow you to sponsor a child, get all that child's information. I kind of recommend people that, you know, maybe sponsor a child from your own village. Yeah. And when you go back, or if you have family there in your village, they can go and check for you.
Yeah.
You know, for me, I'm sponsoring about 200 children. My parents are sponsoring close to 6,500 children. Right. To monitor that many children is very difficult. That's why, realistically, if one family just takes even one child, or even like maybe two child in one household, that would be amazing. Because then it's, don't push it on somebody to monitor your child. Really take responsibility and monitor that child and make sure that your money is going in the right place and that child is at school. Keep a direct open line with that child and, you know, become like a godparent to that child, that sort of thing, basically. Because it's very hard to expect somebody, because otherwise kids will fall through the gaps. No matter where you go, there is a level of corruption, or even sometimes families that come and ask for sponsoring don't actually need sponsoring. But by the time you catch it, by the time you realize, you know, you've paid for a year, and then you realize, one second, this person is a landlord who owns this much land, and there's somebody else who actually needs this. So it's really hard to build up this system. And it's, you know, when you go to official charities, almost 80% of your dollar is used to pay people and for admin costs, you know, and we don't have that. We don't do things that way. So 100% goes just to the school, to that child. But we can't monitor that many children ourselves. Just doing the best we can, slowly, and checking each step of the way and doing things slowly and running a lot of different initiatives. You know, building homes, sending out solar lights, organizing medical care, arranging English lessons for the kids who have potential to go overseas, teaching younger children the basics so that they could sit the test, pass the test to even get a spot in school. So at least with the families that we're taking on, it's not just one problem. It's not just put that child in school. They faced a host of problems because some of them can't even get proper meals.
Yes. All the things that we take for granted. Yeah, all the things that we take for granted. And, you know, I'm one of these people where I count my blessings. And often I get a pen and paper and I write down all my blessings, from having clothes to eating food to having a warm house, having a bed to sleep on, you know, all these basics that we take for granted that other people might, from our community, these are our people that we are talking about, do not have that privilege. So, you know, I think it's great. So you just mentioned there that there was educatetosave.com, and there's other organizations as well where, you know,
directly in India.
So for those people that are thinking, hey, you know what, I want to do something, but I don't know how, contact these organizations. And then there's Give Them for Causes as well. You know, the great work that you are doing there as well. But so we've talked specifically about, you know, the problems in Punjab and how, you know, you've had this inner guidance come up and, you know, for you to be actively doing what you can to help them. But right now we are facing, of course, a global pandemic. We're a year in to when we first went into lockdown. Now, of course, people are struggling. There's been a lot of loss. There's been, you know, loss in terms of loved ones, in terms of financial. Everything has changed in society as we know it. And you are now bringing us a brand new album. And I find your music uplifts. You know, the Girdan, when I listen to your Girdan, it has that transcendental effect. It uplifts me. It helps me forget about anything else that might be happening and just connect with what matters, with the moment, you know, with the Almighty. So the album that you have that you are releasing as well is called Ik, which I found to be so appropriate right now, because it's about unity and about us all remembering that we are united. And this is what the pandemic has taught us, because regardless of race, color, social economic background, the virus does not discriminate, you know? So we are, it's reminding us that no matter what country we live in, no matter how much money we might have, we're all one. We're all one and the same. So this album, Ik, you know, tell us about that. And you know, did you actually think to yourself, right now, this is what people need? Or how did it happen?
So I actually recorded the kind of demo tracks for the album when I was pregnant with my twins, who are 2 years old now. And it's been a slow build up, because obviously having young children, breastfeeding, I also moved countries when they were 4 months. Delayed the album. And so I've been slowly,
it's hard enough moving house, you moved countries.
While breastfeeding twins, that was right. And I have a 10-year-old as well. So settling him into a new school and packing up his life, it was a lot of change for him actually. But with the album and this message of Ik, I feel like the way in which I've recorded this album, I have enunciated the words quite slowly. The melodies that I've composed have allowed me to sing the words in a way that I can enunciate the words so that it kind of moves through the cells of your body. You're clearly hearing and experiencing each word as I sing it. But yet I've brought in the most incredible award-winning musicians to feature on these tracks. And they are literally at one with their instruments. They bring that ache to the track as much as I try to as well. And so even though the melodies are quite simple, the music is complex. It's layered. It takes you up. It brings you down. And just takes you on this kind of journey. And so in creating the album, I wanted to create something that even children could listen to. And when they listen to the album, just even one time, you'll be surprised at how much they would have picked up and learned and how many Shabbats they will know by the end of the album. It's actually 11 tracks on this album. And they're all about 3 minutes. So they're quite radio friendly, which is great because right now they're being played on BBC radio and on the mainstream radio. So it's really great that it's sharing with the wider audience. Mm. I think often that it is within the turbulent times that our humanity awakens and allows us to be more compassionate, which is the highest, the most, it's kind of like when you are coming from compassion, that is when you are connecting to your divine self. Yes. And what Kirtan does is it makes you aware of the shadows within your own mind. It helps you to locate your ego within yourself, which is so cleverly concealed.
Yes.
And in recognizing that that false self, you connect with your divine self. And you will move from that place of love and compassion. And even with creating, you know, yes, you can sit down and you can force yourself that I need to write this, or I need to create something great, or I need to write something great. But true art comes from allowing it to move from within you. And for me, when I was kind of composing and creating this album, it was as though I felt it move through me, and almost not really from my mind, but from my heart, from this chakra, just kind of coming off of me in a way. Versus trying to force it. And so I'm not working towards any deadlines, or I'm not doing this to make a living. I'm trying to bring something out into the world that when people listen to those who seek it, to those that it may find, may it bring those people peace, awareness, recognition, and allow them to connect to their divine self. And everyone who shares it or buys it helps me to help children in Punjab, to educate them, to build homes. So the message all around brings us back to that ache.
Yes. Yes.
Dehi siva barmo he hai subh kar manti kab hoon na daron dehi siva barmo he hai subh kar manti kab hoon na daron subh kar manti kab jab jaye le ro nis chekar apni jeet karo jeet karo deh se va bhar mo e hai sub kar manati kab hoona taro dehi sava bal mo e hai sub kar manati kab hoona taro sub kar manati kab hoona taro
And you mentioned then about compassion and coming from the heart chakra, you know, love, compassion, love is the highest vibration. And I think that that's some very, very striking points that you've made there. And even for anybody watching right now, even if you just take on one of those points, you know, I have so many memories of, as a child, sitting in the Gurdwara and listening to Kirtan, traditional Kirtan, and being blown away. And, you know, and then being blessed enough to find, as I've grown, different styles of Gita, such as yours. And when we can, some people will know that I'm a mindfulness teacher as well. And you know, it's all about being in the moment and living in the moment and focusing on one thing. And when we completely focus, for example, on Kirtan, when I can completely focus on listening to any of your tracks, it just, the sense of peace, the sense of calm, it's just otherworldly. You know, it's just absolutely amazing. But something you mentioned then is you said about how you write and compose.
Yeah.
The instruments that you bring into your Kirtan, you know, they're not always your traditional instruments for Kirtan, which is what makes it so different.
Yeah.
You know, you have strings, you have guitars, you have piano, you have all these other instruments.
Saxophone.
Yes, saxophone. Wow.
Sarangi, shenai.
Yeah. You know, I mean, the sarangi I always find blows me away anyway. But then to combine that with these other instruments, it's just phenomenal. How do you do it? Where do you get your inspiration? How do you know which instruments are going to fit with what? And can you play all these instruments yourself?
No. You know,
how do you do it?
I can play the harmonium, and I often compose on a keyboard or the harmonium. But I hear it in my head. I don't know how to explain it. Like, I'll be maybe sitting in the past when we could go to concerts, I'd be sitting in a concert and there'll be somebody on that stage playing some instrument. And when I'm kind of composing the music, I hear it. I hear it like playing in my head. And I'll immediately go and search the person or the instrument, and I will send a clip to my manager. And I'm like, this person, I need this person on this track. And then he'll go about finding the person for me so that I can stay in my creative zone. Yeah. And keep composing and keep bringing, you know, more and more good things out, hopefully good things out into the world. So it's just kind of, again, it's trusting the sound current within. It's not forcing, it's actually relaxing into it. It's letting go into it. Yeah. And everything, you know, all the realizations, they come. So you go out, you live life, you experience things outside yourself, and then you pray or you meditate, and then you bring these things together to contemplate. And actually, it's when you sit to contemplate, where you're not meditating or praying, and when you're not living your life, but actually taking time to contemplate, that's where you start to hear yourself more clearly, see yourself more clearly, and the realizations come. You know, running around trying to do 100 things, which I swear to God, I've been that person as well. And thinking that is actually the way to live life. Like, you know, you've got to have your job and then side hustle and then side hustle and then do your social media and do this. Actually, there's something wrong with celebrating that. What should be celebrated is balance.
Yes.
Is health, you know, is learning and growing and not staying in the same place. Because the moment you stay still is when you begin to kind of die in a way. It's like, I always say, like, and I try to explain this to my son, because he's 10 now, that everything in this world is energy. And, you know, I'm like, when we've walked in the park and you see these lakes or you see ponds, and I'm like, you see this part that doesn't move, it becomes green and gungy and like a swamp. But in this part where it moves, this is so fresh that you can drink it. So whenever you're feeling moody, which, you know, 10-year-olds start, or you're feeling like this negative energy, you can move that energy out of yourself just by deciding to do something versus sitting there and doing nothing. For example, dance around your room, play music really loud, shift that energy, or write down your feelings, transfer that energy. Just keep your energy moving in some way. Exercise, go out for a walk. And these are the things that's really helped me and my family through this kind of these lockdowns. We have a prayer room. I have a prayer room in my house. We go into the prayer room and we sing Kirtan together. And I have vajas and tablas. And we sound terrible. It's messy. The kids are rolling around on the floor. The twins are fighting to play the tabla. And it's just about, you know, slowly, slowly getting them from that energy to a calmer energy. And then finally, we're kind of singing. And some days we have a really good run and some days we don't. But it's okay. But I feel like I grew up doing that with my family, although I started much later. I started at 10 with my siblings jamming out. But I feel like giving this to my kids is really, really important, because watching my son not being able to meet his friends and go out into the world the way he used to, and just kind of reminding him that there is this world inside of yourself that you can access and you can choose to access. And it's just taking that little bit of time to connect to yourself has been really important. So I do notice him when we're singing Shabbats together, and he plays harmonium. I teach him harmonium and plays, and he plays tabla. So sometimes when we're playing, he's playing tabla and I'm playing harmonium and singing, I notice him zoning out, and I love it. I'm just like, okay, because he's got to get there on his own. I can't force him to get there. I can just, you know, open the door a little bit, and then slowly, slowly he'll take his steps to where he's supposed to get to.
Yeah,
but it's opening that door every day consistently that makes a difference.
Yeah, and exactly you want what you said.
You need consistency, right?
Yeah, and it, like you said, you can't force him, but you can guide. And that just sounds, you know, I have images coming into my mind of you guys in your prayer room, you know, playing the music. It's amazing. And even for people who haven't got instruments, a spoon and a pot, you know, you can make music with anything, you know,
really?
You can bring out that creativity with anything.
Yeah.
So that just sounds phenomenal. So bringing it back to the music, you have got some, you've worked with Talvin Singh in the past. You've worked with some incredible people.
Yeah.
Bringing through different sounds, different creative expressions into the world of Geetan. On this album as well, you know, tell us some of the people you've worked with.
So I worked with Suhail Yusuf Khan. I've worked with Sumik Datta, Jyotsna Sirikrant, Francesca Teberg. I've worked with Oscar Vinzan, who produced the album, and he has been with me since my second album. My first album was produced by Sukhbir in Dubai, but since I recorded my second album, I Bow to You, Vaigru, and then Sacred Words, and now the Ake album, Oscar's been part of all of those. So it was his turn to really produce me, and he's done an incredible job. So yeah, I mean, with each track, I have a different musician featured and a different instrument featured on each track. Jesse Bannister, who plays saxophone, and there is this person on Instagram, Flutewala, and he's playing bansuri on one of my tracks. It's been really a brilliant musical journey, and I think we're also loading up on my social media some of the behind the scenes, so you can see the person playing the instrument and then it merging into the actual track.
Wow.
And you can kind of hear the rawness and what it becomes. So it's really, I'm really, really grateful that I was able to birth this album.
Yes.
And bring it out. You know, when I grew up, like you said, you'd go to Gurdwara and you'd feel blown away. When I grew up, I'd go to Gurdwara and I would listen to Kirtan performed by ragis, always generally male, and playing vaja and tabla. And all the cassette tapes and CDs that ever came out were always like that. And it really resonated with me. It really sparked this passion for Kirtan within me. But when I take my son to the Gurdwara and he sees that same thing, it doesn't create the same connection in him. He doesn't relate to the instruments being played in the same way, or sometimes even the melodies. It doesn't make him feel inspired.
Yeah.
So I always tell him that there are many different ways to express love for God, and all of them are okay. So find your way to express love for God. Find the way that makes you feel inspired and feel connected. And so with creating each album and pushing the sound and bringing in more instruments, all vibrating at different frequencies, you never know what is going to just be that thing that helps that person connect. Like, I kind of see myself as the PowerPoint, and it's just about getting the person to plug in and then they'll connect to that infinite universe. I just hope to be that kind of PowerPoint. And so you never know which Shabbat and which production is going to be that PowerPoint for that individual that helps them connect to that infinite self, that divine self. And so creating all different sounds, using all different instruments, bringing in as many elements as possible, tell me which instrument wasn't created by God. You know, if you want to tell me that you can only sing with vaja and tabla, let me inform you that the vaja was invented in the 1700s by Alexandre Dubain. It was never used by any of the gurus, and it only came to India because it was portable and affordable, and then became a household instrument for Indian households and became a prevalent part in Indian music from that point forwards. But the gurus never touched a harmonium in their lifetime, and even the tabla. So it's, you know, I think people need to kind of educate themselves and stop trying to control the sound, but allow it to flow. And from each person, if we're ink, then that one light resides in all of us. And if we're moving from that light, then that creation is God's creation too.
Absolutely, absolutely. And the thing is, we all have our own expression to release into the world. And that is being done by you beautifully. And you mentioned then about your son and how and what he connects to. And as a mother, you know, I think from what I've experienced as a mother watching you and watching your work, and I say watching now because I've seen a lot of your work in terms of your videos really strike a chord with children. So going back to a Guru Ram Das shabd that you did with the shadows, you know, you know, my kids, I remember my kids being toddlers, you know, they're 7 and 9 now, but they were just mesmerized by that on the TV. Would they just listen to a shabd and resonate with it without that? Maybe not as much, but that really got their attention. They weren't thinking anything else. They were in the moment. They're watching that, they're hearing it. And even now, you know, recently you've just released a Moolmantra with a children's video.
Yeah.
Tell us a little bit about that, you know, your role as a mom. Does that give you more creative expression for children?
Absolutely. So for me, in the most testing times of my life, it was within Kirtan and Guru Nanak's philosophies that I found shelter. And the idea that our children in the future may not have that, because there is a lot of other things pulling their attention. And so I feel like if we don't evolve, then we're not being fair to our children. So creating things that children can connect to and find peace from, or things that make them happy, that's a wonderful thing. Like, you know, our children watch YouTube videos of, you know, these animations of an owl flying and Twinkle Little Star and stuff, and it makes them so happy. But imagine them watching Guru Nanak's Moolmantra being sung as they jet off into outer space to marvel at all of God's creations, the stars, the planets, the sun, all singing, all uniting to bring this message to the world.
Ek onkar sat naam karta purakh nirbho nirvair akal murat ajuni saham gur prasad jap at sach jugad sach happy sach Nanak ho si bhi sach.
So I think children need to see something that they can connect to. They need to see their faces. So, you know, I have a little boy with a juda, a little girl, I have another little boy without a juda. And so I think that they need to see themselves reflected in this world and in the art world. And so creating these like pieces of art for our kids, I've got more things like that coming out too.
Oh,
a second one being made right now for another track. And so just, yeah, I mean, for me, any way that I can help my children and other children connect to Sikhi, whatever it takes, I think it's worth it. It's worth doing it. And they're going to need it more than ever in the future, because I think there'll be more lockdowns. There'll be more times of isolation. As the world moves towards artificial intelligence, there will be less human interaction and contact. And so this may lead to other health issues, such as depression. And if they don't have a way, a place to go, and a way to connect to the infinite source, I think they will struggle more.
Yes.
You know, having a place to go and search for answers is going to be more important to future generations than ever before. That's my prediction, and I could be wrong, but since I feel that way, then I'm going to do something and create something that will hopefully help them.
Yeah, yeah. And, you know, we have this whole treasure source in terms of Sikhi, and basically what you're doing is you're showing people, children and other people, different ways, you know, different options of connecting to that. And, you know, you're right into, and like I've worked with different mental health charities, and they've said, you know, mental health is the new pandemic, because we're going to also see the results of this last year. In the future, we're going to see the implications of that, you know?
Yeah.
And so whatever we can do, you know, to make that difference, to help people through that, is always a good thing. And, you know, the Kirtan is just like you're saying, it's just like a love song. It's like a love song to God, you know? And at any point you can just tune into that love and sing, listen, sing, you know, and just express and know that we're not alone and that we are Ik. And, you know, talking about Ik, tell us more about your album.
So my album drops April 16th. The cover art of the album was actually done by the Singh twins. It's turned out beautiful. We're going to be releasing 1,000 vinyl copies and selling them at £100 a vinyl, but that money will be going towards the children of farmers. So hopefully through friends and family, we'll be able to, you know, do something that will create a difference as well. And yeah, I mean, I hope that the album really makes a difference to people's lives in all ways, from listening to the charity aspect, you know, taking everybody on this journey with me.
That's wonderful. That's wonderful. Well, thank you so much for all the great work that you're doing. And thank you for bringing out your expression into the world and helping other people express themselves as well. So the album drops on April the 16th. I mean, I've seen this cover that you've mentioned there by the Singh twins, absolutely beautiful. You know, I can't wait to hear the music. I can't wait to hear all the
music. I'm really excited too, because it's been signed by 6degrees in the US.
Wow.
And they have informed me that they're going to apply for a Grammy with the album.
Yes.
Which is, I never even kind of thought that Kirtan could kind of reach that place. And it might not happen, it might happen, but just to have an album that your label believes in that much, just to have the album signed to a great label and then the label believes in that much is really something, especially for what is a grain of sand in the world of music, right? So it's still making an impact. That one little grain is still making an impact, so.
No, absolutely. And as you mentioned earlier as well, the genre of Kirtan is not, obviously we know it's not mainstream. And I have come across many artists, maybe, you know, the Bhangra singing artists that will say, no, we're not doing that. We're not going to do anything like that because that's not what the masses want, you know. But you have chosen yourself. And of course, everybody has the right to make their own choices, but you have chosen to bring this out into the world. And as I started talking to you at the beginning by playing the Vaheguru Simran in the background, this is before I knew that anybody called Manika Kaur even existed. It had reached us, the sound had reached us, and we used to play it all the time. You know, and you know, so many different chapters of your work that has reached us until we even knew, okay, you know what, now there's Manika Kaur and this is the work that she's doing. So would you bless us with you know, singing something live for us now before we before we go. Can I put you on the spot like that?
I have to tell you that I'm a little bit rusty, but I have released 51 tracks now, so you need to listen to some of the other stuff, not only this one. I have other Vaigru Simrans, other Mool Mantras, and many, many Shabbats that have been beautifully produced. So you've got to get to the next stuff now.
Yeah, I'm probably like...
There's a blast from the past.
30 tracks. I've probably covered about 30. I've got some to go, but I just love that version. So, you know, we all resonate with what's right for us at the time. And at that time, it was like, wow, what is this sound? Who is this girl? You know, I don't even know how I ended up with that. You know, I have no idea. But once it came to me, that was it. It just got played and played. So thank you. And you just don't know when we release something, how far it can go, where it can go. And I suppose we don't even need to know. We just got a job to do, right? And that's exactly what you're doing. You're bringing it through. So,
Right. Okay. I'm going to cover my head because I'm singing kirtan. Although I do sing kirtan even when my head isn't covered, even if it's controversial, because I sing kirtan when I'm putting my kids to bed, when I'm walking in the park, when I'm taking a shower. I don't think that there should be rules as to when and how you need to be dressed in order to tell God that you love God. But because, you know, for this moment, I have this on me. So when I delivered my first son, I almost died. I was very sick for a long time. And there's this moment that I really remember during that time of my mom sitting next to me in the hospital and just gently stroking my hand. And she kept singing these words to me, which are these words written by Bhagat Kabirji. And the meaning is really beautiful. It's about letting go and accepting God's will in a way, and the peace that comes from that acceptance. When I got better, I recorded that particular Shabbat. I wrote a melody and then recorded those particular words. So I'll sing that.
Vahe Guru, Vahe Guru, Vahe Guru, Vahe Guru. Farida, Farida, Jyot Maran Mukhiya, Tinna Namare Kum, Apnare Ghar Jaiye, Baitna Ti. Chumma Betinati Chumma Vahe Guru Vahe Guru Vahe Guru Vahe Guru Vahe Guru, Vahe Guru.
Next time you have to give me notice. I need a warm up first.
No, that was amazing. That was just amazing. And you know, when I hear the sweet sounds of Kirtan from you, it just takes me to another place. So thank you. Thank you for taking the time to talk to us today at Punjab 2000. We really appreciate it. Thank you for spreading the good vibes that you are. Thank you for the great work that you're doing through Kirtan for Causes. And thank you for helping bring Sikhi through the music to the next generation as well as us. So Manika Kaur, thank you very much for your time today.